Okay, we are live.
All right, let me know when I should let everyone in.
I think you can go ahead and let them in, Vanya.
Okay. Yeah, you can do it now.
Here goes.
Well, good morning and welcome to the new teacher induction ceremony. Muy buenos días y muy bienvenidos to our ceremony this morning. We'd love to welcome our teacher candidates, their families and friends, our UTSA faculty and staff, and our school district partners. So welcome to this happy occasion. My name is Dr. Kristen Lindahl, and I'm the Assistant Dean of Professional Preparation. I'm also an Associate Professor of Bicultural Bilingual Studies in the College of Education and Human Development, and I will be your program host this morning. Our social media hashtags and accounts are listed on the slide below. If you'd like to participate virtually, that would be great. And before we begin our program, we'd like to pause for a moment of silent reflection to recognize and remember students, family, faculty, and friends who have recently left us. Thank you for joining us in that reflection. So as we continue, we will first hear from Dr. Tiffany Fardia Sokolowski, who is an assistant professor of instruction, as well as our US Prep and Raise Your Hand Texas coordinator. So Tiffany, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Lindahl. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to UTSA's Spring 2021 Educator Preparation Program's new teacher induction ceremony. As I sit here before you all today, in front of my laptop, with my face framed by a square, I'm reminded of the many challenges and changes we've all experienced, the plethora of new things we've learned, and the resiliency that makes us stronger each day. I think we can all agree that this past year was not easy. There were challenges like learning how to conduct and participate in Zoom meetings, creating and sharing documents via Google Drive, and as if that wasn't enough, many teachers were expected to teach virtually and in person simultaneously. Now, I know there was so much more happening, but my point is, here we are in front of our laptops, tablets, phones, et cetera, coming together as a community to celebrate and commemorate what our students have achieved and the start of their journeys towards personal growth, towards professional growth, and toward pursuing their dreams. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't share some words of wisdom with you, so I've packaged my knowledge nuggets in a tidy acronym, G-O-A-L, GOAL. I think that GOAL is a suiting acronym because I believe that these are qualities for us all to strive for as we continue to grow both personally and professionally. Starting with G. G is for grace. Things will not always go according to plan, and that's okay. Giving yourself and others grace allows for adaptability, resiliency, and the ability to move forward. O is for ownership. Be proud of the work you do and model that for your students so that, like you, your students can take pride in their learning and be proud of their accomplishments. A is for advocacy. Don't be afraid to turn up the volume and amplify the voices of your students, families, and community. L is for learning. Keep an open mind and remember that we're always learning. Whether it's learning how to rename yourself on Zoom or learning how to correctly say your students' names, learning matters. And this is my goal for you, my dear Roadrunners. May you learn how to give yourself grace, learn how to take ownership in all that you do, learn how to advocate for yourself and others, and learn to keep an open mind. Congratulations to you all. I'm so proud of you, and I wish you the best of luck in all your future endeavors. Keep making us proud. Birds up.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fardia Sokolowski, for that wonderful welcome. And during today's ceremony, you'll hear from other educators in the co-ed who are thrilled to celebrate this milestone with you. So as you listen today and as you move forward in your career, know that all of the faculty and staff in the professional preparation program are so proud of you and grateful to share in your journey. We'd like to continue to honor our district partnerships and recognize our valuable relationships with our district partners who enable us and our teacher candidates to continue our work with San Antonio school districts and students. So thank you and a big virtual round of applause to all of our district partners who make our program possible. We'd also like to take a moment to recognize the faculty and staff in the Office of Preparation and Partnerships who also make the Teacher Candidacy and Educator Preparation Program possible. Thank you to all of you. And now we'll have remarks from Dr. Juliet Langman, the Interim Dean of the College of Education and Human Development, Associate Dean for Graduate Studies, and Professor in the Department of Bicultural Bilingual Studies, the College of Education and Human Development. Dr. Langman.
Thank you, Dr. Lindahl, and thank you also, Dr. Fodia Sokolowski, for those wonderful words. I'm really pleased to see, although I wish I could see, and congratulate each and every one of our clinical teachers, and also to recognize and appreciate our district partners who are here sharing this special moment today. Clinical teachers, I want to congratulate you on the completion of your professional education program and your successful completion of clinical teaching, the culminating set of activities for our educational programs. You have chosen to become a teacher, and we are thrilled that you selected the College of Education and Human Development at UTSA as the place to begin that journey and career path. I want to share three things with you in the brief moments that we have together. First, I want to read a quote from Haim Jinat, who became an elementary school teacher in Israel in 1947 and later earned a PhD from Columbia University and was a child psychologist and parent educator. This is from his book in 1965, Between Teacher and Child. I've come to a frightening conclusion that I am the decisive element in the classroom. It's my personal approach that creates the climate. It's my daily mood that makes the weather. As a teacher, I possess a tremendous power to make a child's life miserable or joyous. I can be a tool of torture or an instrument of inspiration. I can humiliate or heal. In all situations, it is my response that decides whether a crisis will be escalated or de-escalated, and a child humanized or dehumanized. This is a powerful quote that shows just how important teachers are and what a profound influence we have on the lives of our students. Second, because I am a teacher and always seek to make text-to-world connections, I want to share an excerpt from the short story titled 11 by Sandra Cisneros, a writer with extremely strong connections to San Antonio. In my mind, this excerpt connects the quote I just shared with a classroom experience seen through the eyes of a child. And I quote, "What they don't understand about birthdays is what they never tell you is that when you're 11, you're also 10 and 9 and 8 and 7 and 6 and 5 and 4 and 3 and 2 and 1. And when you wake up on your 11th birthday, you expect to feel 11, but you don't. You open your eyes and everything's just like yesterday, only it's today. And you don't feel 11 at all. You feel like you're still 10, and you are underneath the year that makes you 11. only today. I wish I didn't have only 11 years rattling inside me like pennies in a tin Band-Aid box. Today, I wish I was 102 instead of 11, because if I was 102, I'd have known what to say when Mrs. Price put the red sweater on my desk. I would have known how to tell her it wasn't mine instead of just sitting there with that look on my face and nothing coming out of my mouth. "Whose is this?" Mrs. Price says, and she holds the red sweater up in the air for all the class to see. "Whose? It's been sitting in the coat room for a month." "Not mine, not me," says everybody. "It has to belong to somebody," Mrs. Price keeps saying, and nobody can remember. It's an ugly sweater with red plastic buttons and a collar and sleeves all stretched out like you could use it for jump rope. It's maybe 1,000 years old, and even if it did belong to me, I wouldn't say so. Maybe because I'm skinny, maybe because she doesn't like me, that stupid Sylvia Saldivar says, "I think it belongs to Rachel." An ugly sweater like that, all raggedy and old, but Mrs. Price believes her. Mrs. Price takes the sweater and puts it right on my desk. But when I open my mouth, nothing comes out. That's not mine, I finally say in a little voice that was maybe me when I was 4. "Of course it's yours," Mrs. Price says. "I remember you wearing it once." Because she's older and the teacher, she's right and I'm not. "Not mine, not mine, not mine," but Mrs. Price is already turning to page 32 and math problem number 4. I don't know why, but all of a sudden I'm feeling sick inside, like the part of me that's 3 wants to come out of my eyes. Only I squeeze them shut tight and bite down on my teeth real hard and try to remember today I am 11. 11. Mama is making a cake for me tonight. And when Papa comes home, everybody will sing happy birthday to you. But when the sick feeling goes away and I open my eyes, the red sweater's still sitting there like a big red mountain. I move the red sweater to the corner of my desk with my ruler. I move my pencil and books and eraser as far from it as possible. I even move my chair a little to the right. Not mine, not mine, not mine. In my head, I'm thinking, how long till lunchtime? How long till I can take the red sweater and throw it over the schoolyard fence or leave it hanging on a parking meter or bunch it up in a little ball and toss it in the alley? Except when math period ends, Mrs. Price says loud and in front of everybody, "Now, Rachel, that's enough," because she sees I've shoved the red sweater to the tippy tip corner of my desk and it's hanging all over the edge like a waterfall, and I don't care. "Rachel," Mrs. Price says. She says it like she's getting mad. "You put that sweater on right now and no more nonsense." "But it's not now," Mrs. Price says. This is when I wish I wasn't 11, because all the years inside of me, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1 are pushing at the back of my eyes when I put one arm through one sleeve of the sweater that smells like cottage cheese, and then the other arm through the other and stand there with my arms apart, like as if the sweater hurts me, and it does, all itchy and full of germs that aren't even mine. That's when everything I've been holding in since this morning, since when Mrs. Price put the sweater on my desk, finally lets go. And all of a sudden I'm crying in front of everybody. I wish I was invisible, but I'm not. I'm 11. And it's my birthday today, and I'm crying like I'm 3 in front of everybody. I put my head down on the desk and bury my face in the stupid clown sweater arms. This is the power of a teacher, and the importance of our approaching our teachers with empathy, with respect, and with the unwavering belief that each and every one of our students is the best student we will ever have. And that our job is to facilitate their growth and development and create a classroom climate that de-escalates, that humanizes, and that heals. That was 2 things. Now the 3rd. You are beginning your own career as an educator, and your path is going to take you in directions that you never dreamed of. But that is what education does. It takes you places you've never been and maybe never even imagined. My advice, embrace the journey wherever it leads. And while you're on that journey, always take with you your memories of the best days. Always take with you your strategies for the best way to engage the students that you have before you. Always take with you the 11-year-old inside you. Always take with you the professional you are becoming. That is the best you can do for your students. I am sure all of you, all of us, can remember a favorite teacher. Frequently, the characteristics that make them favorite was the very quality of helping us reach our maximum potential, sometimes referred to as pushing, and taking us places we had never dreamed of going. Those are the characteristics that you have learned about and begun to develop here at UTSA, and that you will continue to develop as you move into your careers. As I begin to end, I want to take a moment to thank the people who helped you get to this point, your professors, the staff in the Office of Professional Preparation and Partnerships, the department and dean's office staff who often work behind the scenes and sometimes in a nagging sort of way in front of the scenes to make things run smoothly, your cooperating and mentor teachers and administrators in the field, and the district partners who made your journey possible. And last, but most often first, your family and your friends. They all played a role and lent a hand in some way, enabling you to reach the end of this part of your journey. As you move forward, I hope that you carry the lessons learned here at UTSA and build upon them as you develop as a professional. I hope that you remember every day that you are the decisive element in the classroom, and that you never forget what it's like to be on the other side of the teacher's desk. And remember, as most of you prepare for graduation, commencement does not mean end, it means beginning. Congratulations to all of you.
Thank you so much, Interim Dean Langman, for those insightful words. We appreciate you being here today. Now we will hear from Dr. Belinda Bustos Flores, the Associate Dean of Professional Preparation and Partnerships, Principal Investigator and Founder of the Academy for Teacher Excellence Research Center, and Professor of Bicultural Bilingual Studies. Dr. Flores, the floor is yours.
Gracias. Bienvenidos a UTSA. Hoy celebramos a nuestros docentes porque han llegado a su meta y pronto se van a recibir como maestros y maestras. Welcome to again to UTSA. We can only say that so many times and still feel great. We're so elated that you have joined us today to celebrate our clinical teachers who will soon be fully certified teachers. Clinical teachers, we know you are excited about the next steps to fulfill your goal of becoming teachers. At the beginning of the semester, or your teaching experience, I spoke to you about the College of Education and Human Development Culturally Efficacious Agents of Change conceptual framework. We at the college firmly believe that to serve the diverse students in our community and beyond, teachers must demonstrate that they are culturally efficacious agents of change who are knowledgeable, community-based, and professional. I would like us to consider how these have been realized during this challenging semester and year, like Dr. Farias Solowski spoke about. You know, even those of us who teach or work on different projects, we've been on Zoom, and all of a sudden the Zoom link doesn't work and we're scrambling. That's the challenge that we have in a virtual world. But another challenge is, how do we know we're reaching our students? For some of you, you've had the opportunity to experience either year-long teaching or year-long placement and or other changes in our clinical teaching experience. And you may have been asked, why? Why is UTSA doing these things? I've always done it this way, especially if they're a teacher who graduated from our program several years ago. Well, we keep abreast and are engaged in teacher preparation research, and which recommends that clinical teachers have a depth of clinically rich experiences rather than a breadth of experience. We know that we have done a great job in preparing teachers, but that we can always do better. And that is also the role of an educator, always ensuring that your students are successful and always looking for ways to ensure the success of all. In extending our experience or requiring additional tasks like the EdTPA that some of y'all engaged in. We want you as teacher candidates and clinical teachers to see learners' development over the academic year and also the curriculum over the year. So we have seen the growth in our clinical teachers, and we know that there is an expectation by the districts and also Texas Education Agency. I know sometimes we say, no, we have to do this because this is a TA requirement, and you will soon be saying kind of the same thing when parents ask you, why does my child have to do? And you're going to have to say, the state requires. And unfortunately, we're regulated by the state, and our accreditation is due to the state. So we have to always keep abreast of what the state requires. But we have evaluated you using our performance-based assessment tool, the CTEST, which is very aligned with the T-test, and which you will be evaluated as a first-year teacher. And we know that you will be successful because you have been successful in clinical teaching. As well, at UTSA, we are not followers. We are leaders. We lead in transformation. We are the drivers of change. And as agents of change, as teachers, we are always looking at ways to ensure that our learners have the opportunities to learn, and that in our case, that we're preparing teachers for the realities of the classroom. We've already talked about how many changes we've had in COVID and how it has impacted our daily lives. As I reflect on this year, as you enter your clinical teaching, there were many unknowns. Will I be able to teach online? How will I be able to teach in person with a mask? These were all the questions I'm sure you had in your mind. And I know that there were times where you cried or you said, oh, they're just requiring too much. Yes, we ask a lot because we know that you can perform at that level. And we know that what we ask will prepare you for being a teacher. So as teachers and us as faculty, we have had to adapt to this new environment. And so those experiences have added another set of tools to what we know and are able to do. And this is a key. A culturally efficacious teacher adapts to meet the needs of their students, not the other way around, where we expect our learners to adapt to our expectations. We know what our students are capable of, and we provide the pathway. We provide the mentorship. And like your clinical teaching supervisors, they're there to support you. We employ disciplinary, pedagogical, and community knowledge to engage our learners and their realities. Our daily reality has included what has occurred through COVID, but also the civil unrest occurring in our country and across the world. The pandemic has exacerbated the injustices and inequities that have historically existed in our society, and in which people are marginalized and in which families are struggling to survive. But again, here's our role. We can make sure that what we do in our classrooms ensures the educational opportunities for students and opportunities to learn. We also have noticed that because of COVID, people have realized there are many people who are considered first responders, medical professionals, scientists, police and fire workers, and others, but also teachers. Those parents who have had to teach at home and they have even one child have realized how hard it is to teach. You cannot just tell somebody, here, learn this. It takes certain strategies and skills, and teachers are now considered in many people's eyes as heroes. We are called upon to ensure that each student that you work with, that you touch, you're truly making a difference, not just in the academic sense, but in the totality of each learner, that they see themselves in your curriculum. They see themselves in the materials that you choose and in the books that you choose. This is our superpower. Yes, next slide. I don't think they ever showed my slides now that I look at it, but this is our superpower. We must advocate. And we've been talking about that in our superpower. And you and we, our task is to, again, optimize opportunities, transform lives through education, and provide endless possibilities. And as clinical teachers, I know, because I get to hear the stories. I'm privileged to sometimes see the videos that y'all produce. You have risen to the challenge. You have adapted as professionals. You have sought tools to be efficacious in your practices. You have shown that you have a true love for teaching and recognize that teaching is a political act. Pablo Freire, one of my favorite critical thinkers and philosophers, suggests that teaching is an act of love for humanity, because love is not an act of, is an act of courage, not of fear. Love is a commitment to others. No matter where the oppressed are found, the act of love is commitment to the cause of liberation. But remember that. So when you teach a child to read, do math, understand a map, you are liberating them because they're able to think for themselves. You have demonstrated this love as an emerging culturally efficacious teacher. You now have firsthand experience that when you teach others to read, write, calculate, engage in inquiry and critical thinking, that their ways of knowing and being and valuing them matters. They tell you, good morning, Ms. Lopez. Good morning, Mr. Sanchez. Those days brighten you. I say, you are my favorite teacher. We're hopeful that as the vaccine gets distributed among our population, that, you know, we will reduce the anxiety about coming to school and that we will be able to teach in person. But we also got to remember the tools that we learned and use those tools. We must recognize the inequities that continue to exist in our society and that we're there to help our learners. As dedicated professional culturally efficacious teachers, remember your superpower and ensure that you make a difference in the lives of your students. I am confident that your group of clinical teachers has the confidence and capacity and adaptability to meet the challenges that you will face as teachers. Be proud of your accomplishments and that you are graduating or completing your certification at UTSA. At UTSA, we are proud that external entities are recognizing our efforts. The U.S. News and World Report recently proclaimed the College of Education and Human Development as one of the best colleges of education, and the Department of Educational Leadership and Policy Studies was ranked number 26 in the nation. You say, well, I'm not in that department, but you take courses from that department. Further, the National Council for Teacher Quality recognized our representative diverse teacher production and discover early childhood education acknowledged that we're one of the top 65 best colleges in producing early childhood elementary teachers. Then the Hispanic Outlook has identified the Department of Bicultural Bilingual Studies as number 3 in the nation in the area of bilingual, multilingual, and multicultural education. Again, you all take courses in these departments. So these are all shared celebrations that we have. So remember that you're graduating from a top university and that you have learned from top faculty, supported by the best clinical supervisors and mentors out in the field. Thank you for being attentive. And I hope that today is the beginning of many celebrations. I ask everyone to use your little emoji or whatever at the bottom and do a virtual clap and to celebrate our clinical teachers. Thank you. Remember, UTSA Roadrunner teachers can.
Thank you so much, Dr. Flores, for leading our wonderful educator preparation programs that have resulted in such talented and prepared teacher candidates. We will now go to a short film where we're highlighting the clinical teachers from this academic year, 2020-2021. So please bear with me for one moment while I switch from our PowerPoint to our video. Thank you.
Dr. Lindahl, we're unable to hear the video.
If we were on live TV, this is when they would go to a commercial break. So just take a breath and we'll be with you shortly.
UTSA, when you're accepted into their program, you don't just walk into the college and start learning from textbooks. You really get invited into a network where you get to plug in and find out, where am I going to be a good fit? What grade and what school district? Where can I be most effective? Where can I come and be the most creative and find a home for my style of teaching? My professors have been wonderful in this program. They're some of the best I've ever had. They've taught me so many things that are directly applicable to the classroom. Now that I'm in student teaching, I can think of things that I heard in Dr. Harmon's class, things that I read in Professor Wilburn's class. I think of Professor Nancy Seidensticker. She said, every day that you walk onto a campus, if you're not grateful to be there, you're in the wrong place. So I started out at UTSA as an English major, and I had no idea that I wanted to be a teacher. And everybody always asks English majors, are you going to teach? Are you going to teach? And my answer was always no. I didn't have anything against teaching. I didn't know what I wanted to do, but I didn't think it was going to be teaching. And in college, I got a job and ended up turning into a digital marketing position. And so I worked there for a couple years. And one day I realized that I wanted to spend less time with my computer in a room by myself, and I wanted to be around people more. And so I started working at a preschool with two-year-olds, and that was my beginning of realizing that I had this heart for teaching. My mom homeschooled me in elementary school, and she showed me really the power of love and education put together. And I looked up UTSA's post-bac certification program. I loved the way it was so connected to schooling and districts in the city. And the rest is history.
Well, the thing about, you know, here at UTSA and the program is they're teaching us to be, you know, culturally efficacious agents of change, right? To be professional, to be community-based, and we have to be knowledgeable. So those are the things that I don't think, you know, I could have gotten anywhere else as far as a really stable foundation to be prepared for the work field. One of the things that a teacher told me is that teaching isn't hard. It is hard work. And I believe that one of the ways that we can make change in our education system, aside from anything political, is actually going there every single day with love, compassion, empathy, and just being there for our students. One of the particular moments that was really moving to me was after chess club, right? I stay after school for extracurricular activities. And one of the students, where we were walking out on the way out, he looks up to me and he says, "You're my favorite teacher." And inside, you know, it just melted my heart. So if somebody was contemplating the program here at UTSA, I think that the biggest thing is for them to, you know, try to understand the members here at UTSA, all the faculty and staff. What they do is they invest not only their time, but also into your time as a student. And at that point, you cannot ask for anything better than to have a faculty and staff that really care about what your future looks like.
So I always wanted to help people. I feel like, you know, there's something that was always bigger than myself. So I started with special ed, probably my second semester at UTSA, and I loved it. I think every single one of my practicums has been just amazing. I've had little kids, you know, like third grade. I've had the middle schoolers, and now I finally have high school, which I'm loving it because I always said, you know, I love the little ones, but high school has really been different for me. And I've gotten to connect with students that, you know, I didn't think that I would have these connections with. So I enjoy it. It's really broadened my eyes because it's probably one of the first opportunities I've gotten to where I can be one-on-one with the students. Most of the time, I'm kind of always being shadowed, but this time, like clinical teaching, you're kind of just, hey, you're going to be taking over the class. So it's been really, you know, opened my eyes, and it's been very great for me, I think. You know, it's been a tough year for everyone and every kid. So going into teaching, I don't ever want to be a teacher where I feel like I have to, you know, be strict with students and kind of just being on their backs, because each student comes from such a different family and household that you just never know what they're going through. So always being humble with them will probably always get me the furthest I can go. I never expected to be a teacher. I always wondered what I was wanted to be, but I wanted to help people. So I've started focusing on what was my issue when I was growing up, and that was I never got to identify with someone in class, and that started with the teacher. I always saw the blonde white woman in front of me, and I never found someone that could connect with me in a certain of way of culture, language, and just being able to understand my situation. So I started researching, and I came up with bilingual education. So I came into UTSA as a normal freshman orientation student, and I walked into this office, and they were like, what do you want to focus on? And I really blanked, because I was like, what do you mean? I just want to be elementary school teacher. And they were like, there's so many focuses. There's ESL, general, and bilingual education. And the fact that he said bilingual education brought a spark in me, and I was like, what is bilingual education? And he was like, it can be anything you want it to be. So that started me to start my degree plan and be a bilingual teacher with the focus in Spanish and English, and has made me be aware of so many things that I missed out on when I was a kid. Teaching in elementary is a good focus, so I can grow those little children up and feel like they do belong in this world. Coming in as a student, being Latina, I got to experience many different things in my clinical year. But one thing I will always remember was those smiling faces of seeing someone that the students could identify with themselves. I remember walking into this one classroom, and they were like, what's your name, miss? And I would say, Miss Carvajal. If you can't pronounce it, it's okay. You can say Missy. And the first thing they were like, no, we can pronounce it, miss. Is Miss Carvajal, like I see? And I was like, yes, that's correct. And that made me feel so accepted by the students, by these 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, accepting who I was, who and how to pronounce my name. Overall, it was a good step forward that, oh, this is how I want to feel. I want to feel accepted by these 5-year-olds, because I know at the end it's going to be worth it. Me and that student are going to build a bond by the end of the year, and we're going to grow together.
Sorry for that. There were all of our amazing teacher candidates back to back right in a row. So my apologies, but thank you so much for this spring 2021 new teachers. It's great to hear your perspectives, and we really appreciate the time that you took to make the video with us. So we will continue with our slides now. And our wonderful program, which of course features you, the spring 2021 clinical teachers. So first of all, your professors from the Department of Bicultural Bilingual Studies would like to congratulate all of you, as would all of the professors from the Department of Interdisciplinary Learning and Teaching. And we also send congratulations from the Assistant Professors of Instruction. As well as all of your clinical teaching supervisors. Congratulations from all of us. So we will now present the teacher candidates Candidates, you are all listed in alphabetical order by last name, as well as according to your certification level. So we'll begin with early childhood through sixth grade, and then continue to the all-level certifications. So we will now hear again from Dr. Belinda Bustos Flores, who will talk to us a little bit about our outstanding clinical teachers and those who are graduating with honors.
Thank you again for joining. And we've been celebrating our accomplishments as a college, and we just recognized you in, you know, in the different slides of those of you who are graduating. But again, let's use our little emojis, I call it emojis or reactions. And let's recognize different folks for different things. And that way we are engaged and interacting together. First of all, there's a group of individuals who have either been nominated by their clinical supervisor or their mentor teacher as outstanding clinical teachers. If you have been recognized, and I thought there was a slide, but like all things, things can happen, please raise your hand and the rest of us can applaud them for being recognized as outstanding clinical teachers.
And Dr. Flores, in just a moment, the outstanding clinical teachers, their photo will appear shortly.
All righty. Thank you.
You'll be able to see them all. Yes.
All righty. Well, we can go ahead and show that if you want. And so the other folks that we want to recognize are those of you who are graduating with honors that have honors codes, cords rather, that, you know, perhaps belong to Kappa Delta Pi, or your GPA is either you're graduating cum laude, summa cum laude, or magna cum laude. Now raise your hand if you are graduating with honors, and the rest of us will applaud. Yay, we have lots of you. Wonderful, wonderful. Now, put your hands down, because now we are gonna acknowledge those who are graduating with service cords. Some of you may be also have an honors cord, but if you are graduating and have a service cord, or because you've been engaged in organizations like the Bilingual Education Student Organization or other types, first gen organizations, raise your hand. We want to honor you for the dedication that you've engaged in service to your community. And the rest of us will applaud. Congratulations to this group. Now, if you have belonged to a registered student organization while you've been here at UTSA, raise your hand. Lots of hands going up. Again, congratulations. The rest of us should be applauding. Let's also recognize those of you who have passed your Texas or the famous EdTPA. We're in our second year of EdTPA, and I think we have about close to 20 clinical teachers who have successfully passed the EdTPA, and I know others have passed their Texas. So raise your hand. Be proud of that, because you're well on your way of getting your teaching certification. Those are the gatekeeping things that sometimes keep us from going, but y'all continue studying. Those of you who haven't fulfilled your Texas requirement, we have a lot of resources for you. Okay, last but not least, if you survived and thrived in clinical teaching and becoming a culturally efficacious teacher, raise your hand. I hope I see all hands up. Congratulations again. You know, this past year so far, we know we have about 50 to 20 of our teachers who have graduated from UTSA who were recognized as either first year teachers or teachers of the year. If you have had that when you are first year teachers and get those type of recognitions, let us know. Sometimes the districts don't tell us. And so share your success with coed.com@utsa.edu. And so I think it's all going to be on the last slide, but it's coed.com@utsa.edu. I'm expecting to hear lots of great accolades from this class, as some of you will be recognized as outstanding first-year teachers or as career teachers as you continue in your profession. Thank you, and congratulations again.
Wonderful. Thank you for participating, everybody. It's great to see your faces. And toward the end, we'll actually take a couple of whole group selfies, so be prepared for that. So as we continue... we would like to remind you, and Dr. Flordes, here is your slide on your teacher superpower, but it's just to reiterate, right, that the teacher superpower and that wonderful quote by Paulo Freire about teaching being an act of love. So we will take a moment to highlight some great photos from your clinical supervisors, as well as those who were nominated as outstanding clinical teachers. So we will turn now to the teacher's affirmation led by Dr. Anne Marie Ryan, Chair of the Department of Interdisciplinary Learning and Teaching.
Good afternoon, or good morning, sorry. It's been a full day already for all of us, and welcome. Very excited to be here and to congratulate everyone. And we are going to get ready to do the teacher affirmation. We will have the words shortly in front of us. And as we get ready to affirm our commitment to being teachers for our students and with our students, which is an important thing to remember, I'm going to ask everyone to raise their virtual hand. That's a way for us to kind of affirm that we are committed to this. When we're together physically, we usually stand for this tradition here at UTSA, but this is our way of doing it in a virtual world. So what I'd like you to do is speak this with me. And in this case, if you would like to do this for those of you who are educators, teacher educators, as well as those of you who are educators in schools now, family and friends who are with those of our candidates who are becoming teachers, please do so. So I will treat each and every student with respect, kindness, and compassion, and expect to be treated respectfully in return. I will keep in mind the vital role I play in my students' lives, remembering that I have the opportunity to make a meaningful and positive difference in each student's life. I will approach my students as individuals without prejudgment, and I will work to bring out the best in each of them. I will keep myself open to acquiring new skills and information so that I may continue to learn, continue to grow, and continue to be the best I can be. Congratulations to all the graduates of 2021.
Thank you again, Dr. Ryan, Chair and Professor of Interdisciplinary Learning and Teaching, for leading us in the teacher's affirmation. So we'd also like to share our appreciation with Libby Castillo, Lisa Romo, and the Academy for Teacher Excellence Research Center, specifically Effie Mata, for helping us today with our technology and presentation. Thank you, and a virtual round of applause to all of you. And so as we close our ceremony, I'd like to take this moment to applaud you and your family's commitment to your studies, to yourselves as lifelong learners and agents of change, to the youth of the world, and to the critical role of education in moving toward a more just and equitable society. We are so proud of you. We're glad to count you as our colleagues, and we can't wait to see what you'll do next. So again, here are our social media tags, and we'd love you to share your success stories with us at the email below. And I will now stop sharing our slides, and we'd like to ask if, for those of you who would like to participate, to turn on your cameras and give us a birds up, and we'll take a few selfies to commemorate the occasion. Because what would this year be without some Zoom selfies, right? Okay, so I have you all on the waffle Brady Bunch view. So if you want to put your birds up, I'll count to three and everyone smile, and I'm going to need to take three of them. All right, so here is number one. One, two, three, say rowdy. All right, one, two, three, say rowdy. And And 1, 2, 3. Say rowdy. All right. Thank you again for joining us this morning. We do wish you the best. We hope you enjoy commencement activities. If everyone in the audience, give yourselves, your colleagues, your faculty, and other educators a big round of applause. Congratulations, and enjoy the end of the semester. Take care.